All right, Frank, let's turn to this banned and restricted list announcement. Of course, a week old, and if you watched Magic TV last week, you got to see Paul and I talk about it. And, you know, we'll run through it quickly. In Modern, Jataxxon Probe and Golgari Grave Troll were banned. And in Standard, and this is kind of where the shocker was, Emrakul banned, we all kind of saw that coming. Copter banned, I think we knew it was a possibility, but I don't think that was as sure thing as maybe we thought Emrakul was. And then, of course, completely out of left field, Reflector Mage. What are your thoughts on these bans, Frank?
I didn't think any of them were possibilities, quite honestly, because Wizards hates banning standard cards. They hate it. It's like, it's a mistake, right? Like, you've made mistakes, and it's like a last resort. They didn't ban Collected Company, and that card was everywhere. You know, and that card had like two more sets to go, or you know, whatever, however many weeks. And Reflector Mage is literally leaving with Amonkhet, so you know, it's interesting.
The one thing about the Reflector Mage banning, I'll say, is it does take away the idea that bannings are for mistakes, because I don't think anyone really characterize Reflector Mage as a mistake. Emrakul, okay, there may be a problem there. Copter, sure. I think we all think that there was too much going on for that cost. But Reflector Mage, that's like splash damage. That's like, okay, if we
yeah,
make...
Yeah, I agree. We're already taking some cards out. We might as well take this guy out.
We got to get this guy out. But, I mean, I don't think anyone looks at Reflector Mage or will end up looking at Reflector Mage at this time in Standard and go, oh, man, that Reflector Mage was crazy.
Thank goodness.
What was R&D thinking? You know,
this card is dominating the metagame.
Right. Copter, so I think it was Ifro who pointed out in the chat last week, apparently Copter was originally a 3/4 Vigilance. I mean, that's insane.
Oh, you mean like before, initially?
Before Final Cuts, yeah. It was a 3/4. Everything the same, but it was a 3/4 with Vigilance. Like, what?
Yeah, and then they just moved most of those stats to Heart of Kieran instead. We're like, oh, wait, make Heart of Kieran 4 toughness, and I'll give that Vigilance instead.
Yeah, it was, I mean, you know, it's funny because I was thinking that they had moved it the other direction. Like, there was kind of a last minute, let's drop the crew on it, or let's drop it from 3 mana to 2 mana, and it'll be fine. No, they pulled it back from the other direction, like, you know, the 3/4 Vigilance, maybe it's too good at 3/4 Vigilance. Maybe, you know, maybe that's too much. So
still, I mean, even as a, you know, even then you look, and even as a 3/3, it's still in every deck as a 4 of. You know, Thraben Inspector is crewing it, Reflector Mage is crewing it, Selfless Spear. Like every deck has a creature that can crew it, and it's just ugh.
It was I'll tell you who was shocked by it. Well, maybe not shocked, but a big proponent of it remaining in Standard was Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso. Big fan of the Copter. Thought the Copter could stay and it wouldn't hurt things. He did think the Emrakul had to go. But there were a number of people who had lists and there was all the speculation. I don't think I saw anyone for a second who thought Reflector Mage's neck was on the chopping block.
Yeah, I don't think anyone was like, wow, I just lost to another Reflector Mage deck. Because Reflector Mage, to be quite honest, Reflector Mage is in like... two decks technically. Like it was in the Blue White Flash deck, but it was also in, you know, like Seth's Panharmonicon deck. But that wasn't nearly as large a part of the metagame. The Blue White Flash deck was the biggest culprit there, I think. But you know, that was pretty much it. It wasn't like everywhere.
Yeah. I mean, it's
like you look at Emrakul and there's like every deck that has, you know, a top in like the Black Green Delirium, Aetherworks Marvel, like all kinds of decks had Emrakul, at least one of them in there. And then when you have matches coming down to like, you know, three different Emrakuls on each. Like, not even that, just because they're, like, most of the matches I played in Standard, if I resolved an Emrakul, 90% of the time I just win.
Yeah. No, I mean, I got no truck with the Emrakul banning. I understand why that had to happen. I think we all get it. Emrakul, she was a bit much. She was just a bit much. And I think the real debate swirls around Reflector Mage. So that we don't neglect Modern, any... thoughts on Jataxxon Probe and Golgari Grave Troll biting the dust the way it did?
I could care less about either of those cards. I hope that doesn't sound super callous, but like Jataxxon Probe is not an exciting Modern card, and Golgari Grave Troll, you know, if that's going to help keep Dredge in check, that's super fine. I would have preferred something like Prized Amalgam, I think, or Narcomoeba maybe, because Narcomoeba is one of the main enablers of the Prized Amalgam, but you know, it is what it is. I tweeted at Aaron Forsythe several times afterwards, and I was like, why don't you love Jace? Can't you love your only son? Like, he just wants to make you proud.
It's so funny. I mean, every BNR announcement, you know, there's some version of bring back Jace, bring back Blood Raid, bring back Jace, bring back Blood Raid. And, you know, it's funny. You got to wonder, as they start mobilizing all the power creep and creatures that we've been seeing for the last few years, it's almost like there's a move towards trying to open that door back for Jace, because the more efficient in creatures get, the less of a threat Jace becomes. Not that he's not a threat. Nobody's saying Jace Mind Sculptor is not a threat. Less of a threat. So
Jace will always be a threat, but I, you know, right now we have modern decks that win on turn 3, and Jace isn't even coming down until turn 4. Like, this is not going to be it's going to be a strong card in Modern, but it is not going to be like any sort of end-all, be-all. Like, they unbanned Golgari Grave Troll, which costs 5 mana. It doesn't even get cast, you know, and now that card is getting rebanned. So, like, I mean, you know, I think Jace is more than able to get a chance here.
I think so, too. And we're always pulling for it. So one day, hopefully one day soon, we may see Jace the Mind Sculptor back in competitive play in the Modern scene. I don't know. They seem pretty dead set against it, but hopefully. So I'm kind of excited. Obviously, this standard bannings was kind of a precursor to shake up before the Pro Tour. Wizards of the Coast very intelligently.
Obviously, you wanted to get that announcement out as soon as possible.
Right, and they wanted to, what I love is they got it out in time for the players to be able to test under the new formats, right? Because doing it this week, you know, would be pretty late. Doing it next week would be catastrophically late for all the Pro Tour testing. So
yeah, it's like basically, oh, by the way, that would be like the most last minute of all.
Oh yeah, by the way, all the testing you've done is totally moot now, so GLHF. So
GLHF indeed.
Yeah, so I'm glad they got that out of the way, and it was a good sign. I'm glad to see, you know, whether you agree with the bannings, whether you have issues with what was banned, the idea that R&D is constantly vigilant when it comes to maintaining the health of the format, particularly going into the Pro Tour, because they understand the kind of impact that the decks that come out of that event are going to have for all of us, for all of you at FNM, at kitchen tables everywhere. Those people who play for fun or who are at tournaments that abide by those standard rules, they want to make sure that that biggest platform, that Pro Tour, is going to produce the healthiest format, because that's what we're going to model all of the new format, the new standard format on, whatever comes out.
The other thing is they're going to be looking at even more carefully in the future, because now there's going to be a second banned and restricted announcement, you know, every, you know, 5 weeks or however long it is.
Yeah, no, it's great. I love that. I love that they've done that too. So
I wish they were, honestly, you know, I love, it's going to sound super weird, I like when cards get banned and I like when cards get unbanned, because it's the same reason I like Magic in general. Like, you know, I constantly try to figure out why I've liked Magic for 20 years, you know, and I can't even finish a console game or a PC game. I'm like, I'm just done with this. I'm just going to do a draft. And the reason is because it's a different game every 3 months. Like, every 3 months, Magic is not the same. Like, when I'm playing Aether Revolt Limited, it's a completely different game than when I was just playing Kaladesh Limited, you know, or, you know, whatever. And, you know, because of that, bannings and unbannings feel very much the same. Like, I'm, you know, get rid of the Cathaxian Probe, now I don't have to worry about that card in Modern, and maybe Modern deck, new decks will show up, or, you know, whatever, and stuff like that. And so it's a cool feeling. Like, if you unban Jace, now you have to figure out the Modern format with Jaces, or, you know, Bloodbraid Elf, or, you know, whatever. So it's just it's almost like a completely new format. So
no,
I look forward to it.
I agree. I love the shakeups. I have been a very, very strong proponent of kind of vigorously banning and unbanning in Modern, just to shake it up, just to make it exciting, to keep it fresh. Standard a little bit less so, you know, and we talked a bit last week about whether there should be a watch list, you know, hey, Wizards just letting everyone know, hey, we're worried about blank cards, so just...
That's a good idea, actually.
You know, I think they should do it, just so we all know, like, hey, buy at your own peril.
You know, and then someone, if they're like, man, I just bought 4 Smuggler's Coppers last week, you know, then their friends can be like, well, it was on the watch list, you know, yeah. So it should have been, you know, you got to be a little more vigilant when it comes down to that, because I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
And it also lets people know ahead of time that, hey, we are aware of this problem. We're taking a look at it.
Yeah, yeah. I that's one thing that I would love to see. It'd be great, because any kind of insight we get into how Wizards is viewing the format, I think, is always interesting, too.
Also, like, then there could be, you know, instead of being like, wow, we didn't see that coming, like, then they could be like, oh, well, you know, we're putting this card on the watch list. We'll let you know in 3 weeks if it's, you know, if it's going to be safe or not, you know, whatever, something like that. So Yeah, that seems like such a simple idea, but it gives so much more transparency to like the process, and as you know, it makes people more confident or comfortable whether to buy cards or not buy, you know, individual cards. So
yeah, no, I agree. So, all right, let's move on to this Wizards of the Coast Digital Studio. Did you see this announcement, Frank?
I have.
So, you know, there's not much to go on. Obviously, I guess it was last week, Chris Cox made an announcement about kind of the direction of the company, very short one. And then now we see this, you know, he was directly referencing the birth of this studio in that announcement. What do you think this means for Magic Online? What do you think this means beyond Magic Online?
So everyone has said great things about Chris Cox in terms of, you know, his leadership and his, you know, his position at Wizards right now. He's the new CEO. You know, all that aside, like, I was actually a little frustrated about this article. Ideally, I imagine we'll post it somewhere for people. But, you know, when I read this, I was like, this doesn't say anything. Like, it just tells you nothing. And, like, you know, as someone who has, I have a significant Magic Online collection. Like, I think it's probably, I think I got it, like, I threw it into one of those card appraisers on, like, one of the sites, and it was, like, $12,000 or something. Something absolutely ridiculous, because I've been playing Magic Online since literally, you know, the beta back in the day.
Sure.
And so, like, you know, as someone with such a sizable collection, like, it makes me uneasy to think there is a future where Magic Online is, you know, obsolete or, you know, phased out or what have you, because I don't know if they're going to go to any great lengths to compensate people for the money or the value of their you know, their collections in a trading card game, in a collectible card game, you know? So I don't know. Like, it's a weird feeling. Obviously, I want what's best for Magic, and I want what's best for digital Magic as well, because I think that's the realm you want to be in. Like, digital games, digital card games, you know, that's the future. Like, you know, you're going to watch games like Elder Scrolls Legends or Hearthstone or, you know, Eternal, and you're going to get left behind if you're producing a subpar digital product, because it's just so much more accessible to people. But yeah, you know, I have concerns obviously about the existing software and, you know, what's going to happen to that. So
I don't think so. I'm not concerned with that. You have a lot more Magic Online cards than I do, but I don't think they will ever abandon that that particular game, the game of Magic played digitally, and it'll always require cards which you have on your account. I don't think that they would ever move away from that.
I hope not, because that seems real crazy to do.
Right. I think they'd move beyond it in some ways, in the sense that, like, I think first of all, I think the studio's probably put together because, as we all know, as we've talked about ad nauseum on Magic TV, the UI for Magic Online is not the best. So it needs improvement, and that's part of, I think, what this studio is going to focus on, hopefully, is delivering not a different product necessarily, but a better version of Magic Online. So that's one. And then there's other things that came up, like the idea of an MMO with Planeswalkers in it, or, you know, Magic license stuff. And I think that's a great direction, digital direction for Wizards of the Coast to go in, where they have a great license. They have this great game. It's recognizable everywhere, worldwide. You know, it's... I think they have a huge
fan base now that can recognize characters and relate to them and be like, oh, cool, you know, I love Jace, I love, you know,
Chandra, you know, Liliana, yeah. Nissa, Gideon, Johnny.
Saying of legendary creatures, non-planeswalkers, and I actually blanked. I was like, what's a, give me a legendary creature.
Oh, you mean, like Gerard, Neri, Krovax. I mean, I can just go on and on here.
Yeah, you know, Hannah. You know,
definitely. People are like, what the heck? These characters are awful. Who are these characters?
Who are these? They go look up Gerard, and they're like, wow, this is rare. This was definitely a myth back in the
day. Oh, jeez, yes. What is he, a 5-mana 3/3 or something? Gerard Capation? Anyway, you'd love to see this license explore other avenues. And of course, Dungeons & Dragons is another Wizards of the Coast license. And there's discussion about how do you take Dungeons & Dragons beyond Baldur's Gate, you know, old school video game that was basically a video game version of the Dungeons & Dragons, you know, role-playing game, was hugely successful. I think you can download it on, like, your iPad and stuff.
You can probably download it on, like, your phone now.
Yeah. But, I mean, so you could see them kind of next-genning something like that. I have no reservations about what's going to happen with Magic Online. I think you're totally secure, Frank, and I think this is just such a good move. It's a great direction for Wizards to turn to, because it's where they need to be turning. Like, digital gaming is such a huge industry, and they have such a great game, and they have such a great license, and they're just not doing enough with it. So hopefully this means they're going to start doing a lot more with it.
Well, you know, I just moved to Florida from Seattle. Like, I know a lot of the Wizards guys, and like, they're like, I saw recently even that Worth Wolpert was let go from Wizards. So like, it really makes me wonder like what they're really doing some shakeups right now in terms of digital. And I think that's, you know, I'll say I think that was needed 7 years ago, you know, 8 years ago. Like, this is something that's been in dire need for a while now, and you know, it's nice to see it happening, but it's sad to see people that have been with Wizards for ages like, oh, or you know, losing their positions, and like, that sucks. But you know,
I mean, yeah. You know, it's that funny thing. Yeah, changes need to be made in terms of increasing the digital product. And yes, I wish they were done years ago. And obviously, that's the kind of improvement we all want. Nobody, I have lost a job before. I have been laid off. Trust me. Nobody wants to see anyone lose a job. It's, you know, so that part's not good. And we always hope that the company can go in a different direction and take everyone with them and just kind of reevaluate priorities for that person or just point them in a different direction. Sometimes that's possible, sometimes not possible. So, whereas I'm very excited about the digital studio, Worth particularly, I mean, Worth, you know, hashtag blame Worth. Worth took on so much ownership and responsibility for that product. He was not the only person that worked on it. And who knows what kind of authority he actually had. So I think, you know, he was with Wizards of the Coast for a long time and was a professional Magic player prior to that. I don't know if you're, you know, Worth was definitely an old school pro.
Yes.
But sad to see him and all the others. Because, you know, the thing about that company, and this is definitely true of Worth Wolpert, is they've got a good team in there who, whether you're sad or angry or frustrated with the product, they really care. The people who work at Wizards of the Coast really, really care about Magic the Gathering. They are true believers who love the game. Same with D&D. So
I agree with you completely there. But the problem has always been that despite how much love they had, you know, Wizards of the Coast has never been a digital studio. It's you know, you look at a product like Hearthstone and it's super polished. And like, whether you know, love or hate Hearthstone, I totally get it. It's, you know, it's your opinion. But you know, it's a well-polished game. You know, it has great sound effects, it has great voice acting, it has great animation. It's simple to load up and play on an iPad or even a cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you can tell that it came from a digital studio. And like, a lot of the products that Wizards produces, you know, Wizards of the Coast is not a digital studio, and it's evident in a lot of the things it produces. So,
well,
you know, if they're able to change that and go in a different direction, I think that's where they want to be.
They have a digital studio now. That's what that this is it, Frank. This is the change. They've done it. They finally listened to you. Someone somewhere finally listened to you, Lepore.
It's nice that they went, you know, they probably went back in time, watched this, and then created the digital studio. So that's all it took. Just a little time travel.
Just a little time travel, nothing big. All right, that is our Magic TV for the week, which means all we have left is this week's Top 8.